My clear shoulder to the wheel.
And away we go!
Into the interior. A vast subdivision antennae of television to the meaningless sky. In life-proof houses, they hover over the young. Sop up a little of what they shut out. Only the young bring anything in, and they are not young very long.
Just ahead, over the rolling wheat fields, all gold beneath the distant snows of Estes, I'd be seeing old Denver at last. There were smokestacks, smoke, rail yards, red brick buildings, and the distant downtown gray stone. I stumbled along with the most wicked grin of joy in the world among the old bums and beat cowboys. I felt like an arrow that could shoot out all the way.
A high tower on a wide plain. If you climb up one floor, you'll see 1,000 miles more.
Right over those knolls over there, something wonderful is going to be. But you found out the more you went, there was just more knolls.
So, in America, when the sun goes down, and I sit on the old broken-down river pier watching the long, long skies over New Jersey, and sense all that raw land that rolls in one unbelievable huge bulge over to the West Coast, and all that road going, I think of Dean Moriarty, I even think of old Dean Moriarty, the father we never found. I think of Dean Moriarty, I think of Dean Moriarty.
Well, I don't think there is any real Neo. Kerouac, I think, had a sort of an idealized figure of Neo as this on-the-road character. I mean, he's sort of the on-the-road personified.
It was such an overwhelming trip. Kesey, I don't know. I it's hard to even know what to say about Kesey. He was so singular. He was the first person I met who he himself was the art. A lot of people thought he was crazy, you know, a lot of people were afraid of him, and most people I know didn't understand him at all, you know. But he was like a musician.
He was like Charlie Mingus. He played the bass line. Whatever else happened was happening around his bass line, and he used the gearship and the bus, and that kind of going.
Jack was in poker faces. Back with bits. Real hunched at the wheel, putting everyone in stitches.
All right, see you, Peter.
Bragging about some nurses screwed while driving through Nebraska. When she came, she honked the horn.
Kesey was a sort of self-taught prison boy who came to New York to go con Kerouac into teaching him how to write.
He was a great driver. And I don't mean a fast driver, I mean a great driver. His page was this highway, and that his writing tool was one of these cars.
All right, there we go. One-handed delight. That's masturbating. No.
Nothing in the world he liked better than getting about 6 scared kids in the car and bring them back about 3 days later, and their eyes looked like fried bolts.
His special thing was that he could remember the chain of thought that went before that led up to a moment of conversation.
Came in here yesterday and jumping and jittering around, and I saw it looked like I was high, so I just let people think I was high. Everybody has forms, everything's known, and the forms are changing. There's no life in the forms.
And just his whole body language and everything was so communicative. It was just amazing.
It's already too late. The Pentagon's taken care of all that. We're doing this deliberately, as far as that goes.
The Pentagon is doing what to the brother?
Well, I don't know who's running the country, do you?
We began rolling in the foothills before Oakland and saw stretched out ahead of us the fabulous white city of San Francisco. No more land, yelled Dean. Can't go no further because there ain't no more land.
The war displaced everyone, and they didn't go back home. It was a little like after any war. was certainly like after the Civil War, when people like Mark Twain were displaced and ended up in San Francisco. He was a carpetbagger in the way, just like the East Coast beats were all carpetbaggers, including myself. We're in a tradition of dissidents. So we started City Lights. The idea was to create a literary meeting place.
There was already cultivated a San Francisco Renaissance. There always was a anarchist, pacifist, anti-Stalinist, anti-authoritarian, literary, bohemian, anti-war circle.
People who want to be themselves, basically. People who want to remain true to their very being. People who don't want to play the game. People who want to be whatever they are.
And that manifested itself in literature, in painting, in bohemian parties, poetry readings.
I would go into a macho bar and jump on the pool table and read some poems. Now, either I got beat up or I made $50. Most of the times I made $50. It was a cold night in the big city where love is the roar and death is the beat, and I yelled like a madman at the top of my voice. Everybody sing, everybody sing. And I started to sing a song about pretty flowers. And then the men in their white coats came with their jackets, and I told them to sing also. Let's sing a song, let's sing a song. And they took me away, away, away from the roar and the beat, the beat, the beat. Let's sing a song.
Like, man, I'm here, and I mean, I've met a swinging group here. I like Frisco the most, man, because, I mean, the town jumps, you know? I mean, there are a lot of scenes, man, and so, I mean, it's like that, you know?
Uh-huh.
Kenneth Rexroth, there's sort of the philosopher, the anarchist philosopher who preceded us in San Francisco, said that San Francisco was to the artists as Barcelona was to the Spanish anarchists. That is, it was a haven for thinking and feeling people. In those days, we were all outlaws. Anybody who had feelings of their own or had their hair a little bit too long or had an idea of their own or wanted to experience new states of consciousness or to deepen themselves or to grow a soul or to feel anything out of the ordinary was a renegade.
I'm Stephen Ronan, beat historian. Here I am at 3119 Fillmore, location of the former Six Gallery, where poet Allen Ginsberg debuted his poem Howl, and history hasn't been the same since.
Rexroth had been invited to organize a reading at the Six Gallery. He suggested to McClure or myself that we organize it, and it fell to me. And Rexroth gave me Gary Snyder's address. Snyder was a student studying Chinese, Japanese, and Zen.
Allen and I lined up that space with the idea of holding a reading for our various relatively unpublished friends.
What we were interested in was our own writing and talking with people who were also trying to write and paint and whatever else, and trying to get our way someplace else, or get a new start that would gently replace a lot of this slobber.
And we stepped out on the stage.
With Kerouac in the audience, with Neil Cassidy in the audience.
We didn't know who would be there, or we didn't know who to expect.
I followed the whole gang of howling poets to the reading at Gallery 6 that night, which was, among other important things, the night of the birth of the San Francisco Poetry Renaissance. Scores of people stood around in the darkened gallery, straining to hear every word of the amazing poetry reading as I wandered from group to group, urging them to glug a slug from the jug, or wandered back and sat on the right side of the stage, giving out little wows and guesses of approval.
Kevin was only half as far that night, listening to the burnt phrases, when I heard the poet out, rhyming erection.
When Allen read Howl, we all knew that a line had been drawn in the sand. We decided we would put our foot on that line that Allen drew.
I was there, and the next morning I sent a telegram to Allen Ginsberg saying, I greet you at the beginning of a great career. When do we get the manuscript?
I had a conversation with Rexroth the next day. I said, gee, I'm gonna be famous in San Francisco or North Beach. And he said, you're gonna be famous from bridge to bridge.
The first edition was printed in England. It was seized by the U.S. Customs in San Francisco. All during the trial, we were still selling it.
We never took the book out of the window.
There were a series of trials in the late 50s that liberated the word, and that meant a whole spiritual liberation after that.
It's really hard to get that kind of publicity.
What I've always loved about Allen is precisely his bravery. I once wrote a poem about him. It went like this. Sometimes I think that ugly little queer, that four-eyed kike, is the bravest man in America.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked.
Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night. With poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats floating across the tops of cities, contemplating jazz. Who cowered in unshaven rooms and underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall. Who got busted in their pubic beards, returning through Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York. Who ate fire in paint hotels or drank turpentine in Paradise Alley. Death or purgatory, their torsos night after night, with dreams, with drugs, with waking.